Hello again from VK3 Alpha Mike Lima with the usual Saturday night test transmission. A bit of explanation before we go on to the main body of the transmission. These Saturday night tests were started as a kind of a tradition by the late Tony Sanderson, the original VK3AML, or at least the VK3AML that was issued under Sanderson's name between 1966 and the start of the 1980s. Tony was based at 23 Park Street, Elstonwick, as you're probably seeing on the screen at the moment, had a massive antenna, only worked on 160 metres AM, but had a quality of audio that was quite surpassing anything that was then on broadcast band AM. And his studio equipment was built into a former linen closet, as you'll see here. These films were taken by Mark Mercer, who was then VK3ZMM, back around 1971, and they come to you with the courtesy of VK3ASE, who digitised them. Tony started the process of pushing the bounds of ham radio to include material that would be of technical interest to people, hopefully above and beyond the normal run-of-the-mill of conversations back and forth of little consequence. Tonight, initially, I'm going to be running the sort of material that Channel O was running when they first did test transmissions. Those of you who remember Channel O, Channel O was the fourth of the Melbourne TV stations. Channel 2, 7 and 9 had opened back at the end of 1956. Channel O officially opened on August the 1st, 1964, but for about 5 months before that, Channel O had been running test transmissions, and the sort of documentary films that I'm going to be showing tonight are very similar to those that you would have seen on Channel O in those tests. And frankly, I think that the test material that they sent out at the first half of 1964 was the most interesting stuff they've ever transmitted on the O10 network. Anyway, be that as it may, the first of the documentaries I have for you tonight I know will be of particular interest to one person who's looking in on the live stream, Mike Groth, VK7MJ, who actually got his qualifications in PhD in radio astronomy, physics, from the University of Otago back in the 1970s. This is a documentary on the state of Australian radio astronomy in 1958, surprisingly shot in colour, and made available to me by CSIRO. I've done a lot of restoration of the audio on these. There was a lot of hum on it, very lumpy frequency response. I flattened that. So hopefully it'll mean something to those listening on 147.475 megs, as well as those watching on the live stream. The live stream can be accessed by Googling a phrase. That phrase is VK3AML 11 September 2021. That's VK3AML 11 September 2021. So on to the CSIRO film on radio astronomy in Australia 1958.
Astronomy is the oldest of the sciences. Since the dawn of history, the sun by day and the myriad stars by night have never ceased to fill man with wonderment and awe. Space is populated by millions upon millions of stars, each like our own sun, but incomparably more distant. They are associated into huge groups, often visible as spectacular clusters and nebulae, each a separate star system like the Milky Way to which we belong. We know these things because astronomers with their powerful telescopes can actually see and photograph the light waves from far distant stars. But the discovery that radio waves were also reaching us from outer space has led to the building of completely new kinds of telescopes, radio telescopes, to track down where these radio signals are coming from and what they mean. And so began the science of radio astronomy, using radio waves instead of light waves. Light waves come in a variety of wavelengths. White light is a mixture of wavelengths. They can be seen as separate colors when white light is passed through a prism. The shortest wavelength we see as violet light, and the longest as deep red. Radio waves are about a million times longer, and radio astronomy is concerned with those from about 1 centimeter to 30 meters. Radio telescopes are basically similar to optical telescopes. Just as optical telescopes use a concave mirror to collect the light waves and concentrate them to give a visible image, so radio telescopes use a concave reflector of metal or wire mesh to concentrate the radio beam and pass it on to a suitable receiver. Only the waves coming from the direction in which the radio telescope is pointed are focused and recorded. Those from other directions do not reach the receiver. It can therefore be used to tell from which direction the radio signals are coming. By using this radio telescope, the radio signals are collected, passed to a special receiver, and recorded on a moving paper strip. The telescope scans the sky, and if it points near a star sending out radio waves, such as the sun, the signal increases, reaching a maximum when it points directly at the sun. The larger the telescope, the sharper and narrower the hump, and hence, the more accurately we can fix the direction. But as large telescopes are costly to build, various methods have been devised to give almost the same results with smaller ones. A small radio telescope gives a broad hump response. When two or more, spaced some distance apart, are connected together, this response is broken up into a series of narrow ones from which it is possible to fix the direction of the source much more accurately. This arrangement is called an interferometer, and one of the earliest was set up in 1946 at the entrance to Sydney Harbour. It appears to have only one aerial. But as the sun rose, radio waves reached this aerial direct and also after reflection from the sea. This is equivalent to having two aerials and no sea, and so it behaved as an interferometer. It recorded the signals from a strip of sky narrower than the diameter of the sun. In February 1946, strong signals were recorded from somewhere within this band of the sun. One of the largest sunspots ever seen was visible at this time. Several days later, the sun had rotated to a new position, and radio signals were coming from this direction. To investigate this association of radio signals with sunspots, a special interferometer was constructed at Potts Hill Reservoir near Sydney. This one was, for many years, unique to Australia. These 32 aerials, each 6 feet in diameter and mounted accurately in line, register signals from a strip of sky about one-tenth of the sun's diameter. As the sun moves across the sky, the radio waves from each successive strip of it are recorded in turn. These are usually stronger from the rim of the sun, and the radio sun is larger than the visible disk represented here by a coin. Sometimes a pronounced hump on the chart showed that very strong signals were coming from one particularly active part of it. There was usually a prominent sunspot to be seen when this occurred. To pinpoint exactly the positions of these active areas, this imposing array of 64 separate aerials, each 19 feet in diameter and arranged in the form of a cross, has recently been erected near Sydney. It is known as a crossed grating interferometer. Each aerial is mounted on its own polar axis, and all 64 can be moved in unison in small steps so as to follow the sun across the sky. One line of aerials responds to radio signals from these narrow segments of the sky. The second line, at right angles, responds to signals from these segments. By special methods of connection, only the radio waves from these small areas are recorded. Each area is about 1/100th of the sun's disk. As the sun moves across the sky, it is scanned by one of these spots and the radio waves recorded. The aerial system is then changed so that the grid of spots takes up a new position, scanning now an adjacent strip of the sun. By repeating this process, the whole face of the sun can be charted. Radio pictures already made show that, although radio waves are coming from all parts of the sun, they are much more intense from certain localized areas, which we call radio spots. Comparing this radio map with a photograph taken at the same time, it can be seen that the radio spots coincide with sunspots when they are near the center, but are otherwise displaced towards the rim of the sun. This suggests that they are located in the sun's atmosphere above the sunspots. And this is definitely confirmed by this radio spot shown right outside the visible disk, obviously well up in the sun's corona. These spots are up to 50,000 miles above the surface. Radio astronomy shows that radio waves are being generated continuously in the sun's corona, and from their intensity, we know that although the sun's surface is at a temperature of 6,000 degrees centigrade, the outer corona must reach a temperature of about 1,000,000 degrees. In addition, occasional but very intense bursts of radio light are emitted from the sun. These last for only a few seconds or minutes, and again, come from the general vicinity of sunspots. To investigate these short period disturbances, a special telescope was built. It is, in effect, a radio frequency spectrograph. Its three aerials are pointed at the sun and then follow it across the sky from sunrise to sunset. Signals from the sun are fed into receivers which tune rapidly over a band of from 1 to 7 meters, then to a cathode ray tube. An increase in signal causes the spot to jump upward. When a disturbance lasts only a few seconds, it is called a burst. Bursts occur at random wavelengths and are roughly analogous to a lightning flash. Outbursts are more spectacular. This record has been speeded up to show that they slowly increase in wavelength. Outbursts are quite possibly the result of explosions deep in the sun. The increase in wavelength is attributed to a disturbance traveling outward. Here it is again. Their speed has been estimated to be about 500 miles per second. Faster still are the high-speed bursts, changing much more rapidly in wavelength and shot out at about 50,000 miles per second, 1/3 the speed of light. Usually, several high-speed bursts precede an outburst. Particles shot out from the sun during high-speed bursts sometimes hit the Earth, when they seem to be associated with cosmic ray effects. They are followed a day or two later by streams of slower-moving particles from the outburst. These are the ones which cause magnetic storms and auroral displays. And so, radio astronomy gives us some advance warning of when they're likely to occur. The Sun is not the only radio transmitter in the sky. Jupiter, the largest of the planets, broadcasts radio waves strongly. They sound rather like atmospherics from a distant thunderstorm. The cause of the signals is obscure. They come from the vicinity of spots, quite possibly dust clouds, which are observed occasionally in certain parts of Jupiter's atmosphere. But the really outstanding broadcasters of the skies are the radio stars. The first investigations in Australia were made at Dover Heights near Sydney in 1946. Strong radio waves were recorded from parts of the sky as they rose above the sea. Often the signals came from areas where there were no bright visible stars, and so the name radio star was coined to describe something that emitted radio waves more strongly than light. The Crab Nebula was the first visible object to be identified as a radio star. It is the remains of an exploding star first seen by Chinese astronomers 900 years ago. Another radio star in an apparently blank part of the constellation Cygnus was not identified until special photographs had been taken with the 200-inch telescope at Mount Palomar. It turned out to be two great star systems colliding with each other, almost at the fringe of the visible universe. One of the most powerful telescopes in the world for studying radio stars is the Mills Cross. Each arm is 1,500 feet long and contains 500 separate dipole aerials working at a wavelength of 3.5 meters. The Mills Cross has already charted over 1,000 radio stars. It works like this. One line of aerials responds to signals from this narrow strip of sky, and the other to signals from this region. When the signals from both are combined, the only signals recorded come from the part of the sky where the beams overlap. This is about 3/4 of a degree across. The beam can be moved to the north or south as desired by connecting the separate aerials in different ways. Hence it is possible for most parts of the sky to pass through it once a day. A second cross, more than twice as long and working at a longer wavelength, 15 meters, has now joined in the hunt. The radio stars fall into two groups. If we plot the brighter ones on a map of the skies, most of them fall in or near the Milky Way. These include the Crab Nebula and this bright patch in the constellation of Orion. The faint radio stars, however, are located around us in a more haphazard fashion. These are other galaxies or systems of stars, some enormously distant from us. Some seen by large telescopes look like giant Catherine wheels. These are the spiral nebulae, their long trailing arms consisting of stars, clouds of dust, and hydrogen gas out of which new stars are born. Astronomers have long suspected that our galaxy, the Milky Way, might be a spiral nebula. It is difficult to be sure about this by optical methods because the hydrogen clouds are completely invisible unless lit by a nearby bright star. And large dark clouds of dust in various directions completely hide what lies beyond them. Light waves cannot penetrate these clouds, but radio waves can. And further, the hydrogen clouds can easily be detected by radio methods because they send out radio waves of one characteristic wavelength near 21 centimeters. This wavelength is not quite constant due to the rapid movement of the clouds relative to the Earth. You have probably noticed that the whistle from a train sounds higher in pitch as it approaches than when it is moving away. Very much the same way, radio whistles from hydrogen clouds are shifted in wavelength. In this direction, if they are approaching, and in the opposite direction, if they are moving away. From this change in wavelength, the speed and distance of the clouds can be estimated and charted. Australian radio astronomers have thus mapped the position of some of the hydrogen clouds. Other clouds, not visible from Sydney, have been plotted by European observers. A definite spiral pattern is beginning to emerge. By contrast, this is the only part of our galaxy optical astronomers have been able to explore, even with the largest telescopes. Radio astronomy is thus giving us, for the first time, a more complete picture and confirms we are, in fact, living in a spiral nebula. Hydrogen signals have also been identified from the clouds of Magellan, which are the nearest of the external star systems or galaxies to us. By radio, these clouds look much larger, showing that the hydrogen spreads out much further than the visible stars. hydrogen signals are also being picked up from other star systems which are very much more distant. Perhaps every galaxy is enclosed in a large envelope of gas. There are countless numbers of these star systems scattered throughout space, all apparently rushing away from us. The faster, the further away they are. Very large and powerful radio telescopes are needed to study them in detail. One with an aerial 250 feet across has just been completed at Manchester, England. Plans are now being finalized for another giant instrument soon to be built in Australia near Sydney. It will have an aerial 200 feet in diameter. Radio astronomy has made remarkable progress in the few years since its birth in 1946, and Australia's contribution has been quite a significant one. Radio astronomy enables us to see some things in a completely new light, to see others that are not optically visible at all, and to reach even further out into space than optical astronomers can. Radio astronomy is thus helping to uncover some of the fascinating secrets of the heavens, how stars and galaxies are born, live, and die, and whether the universe is really expanding or not. But it is still very much in its infancy. The full story must be left for the future to fill in.
As I said at the start of this film, these sort of documentaries were shown in the test transmission phase of Channel O in Melbourne in the first half of 1964. And at that time, Channel O was built out in the bush that is now only a kilometre from me in that direction to the north, by Reg Ansett initially, and built out in the open fields, which are now well and truly built up as the suburb of Forest Hill, was then known as Burwood East. Another documentary covers an area related to radio, only in an oblique way. This material will be known to most of you who construct electronic gear. It's Bakelite. Paper Bakelite, which was the first thermoplastic ever devised, the first fully synthetic material, a thermosetting plastic, devised by Dr. L.H. Bakeland in New York in 1907. Not generally known, one of the first commercial applications of Bakelite was as the surface material for these. Thomas Edison was changing over from making cylinders of recordings to the disc recording process, and in casting around for a surface material that was superior to the shellac that most companies were using, he came up with Bakelite. He called it condensite varnish, surface material only for these three-ply discs. They're quite thick, a quarter of an inch thick, and they're cut by what's known as the Hillendale process. They're quite unstandard compared to most 78 RPM discs. But the surface material there was one of the first commercial applications of Bakelite. Later, after 1921... the Edison discs were made still with Bakelite surfaces, but with paper labels like this. That's an Edison disc pressed about 1922, nearly 100 years ago. Frightening to think of, isn't it? But let's get on to a documentary on Bakelite. Not many people seem to know much about it. The Bakelite materials now, the artifacts pre-war, high art deco made of Bakelite, are highly collectible. And in a very interesting documentary, a surprisingly interesting documentary, Lowell Thomas, the well-known pre-war narrator of the Movie Tone newsreel in America, narrates this documentary on the first of the synthetic plastics.
Our modern complex industrial world has found them insufficient and has turned elsewhere to fulfill its needs. Turned to a fourth kingdom, a kingdom of scientific research, a new domain of man's own creation, a world of primary substances which never existed before. The aristocrats of this new realm are the phenolic plastics, of which Bakelite resinoids are the first family.
Wherever you turn today, there's pretty sure to be a modern plastic in use somewhere within sight.
Yes, that's why my editor wants a story on the industry and its background.
Well, of course, natural plastic materials are as old as recorded history. But the so-called modern plastic first became a factor in industry in 1907. That's the year that Dr. L.H. Bakelite announced his invention of an entirely new synthetic substance, phenolic plastics. They were the first in industrial importance.
How would you class his invention? Accidental or premeditated?
There's your answer. Those are Dr. Bakelite's original laboratory notes and records of tests. 8 years of them.
This begins to look like a tough assignment.
Plastics, that is, the so-called modern ones, are more complicated than metals. But now that we know their secret, they're easily explained.
Remember, I'm only a reporter. And what's more, I had an awful time passing high school chemistry.
I tell you what we'll do. We'll use Dr. Bakelite's original formula for our demonstration. Now, he started with two main raw materials. Phenol, commonly known as carbolic acid, and formaldehyde.
Aren't they the chemicals used for disinfectants?
That's right. For the first part of the process, all we need is this burner, this flask, and this reflux condenser.
Just a moment, please. What's the reflux condenser for?
Well, that merely returns the condensed vapors to the flask. Now, the flask already contains the proper amount of phenol. Now we pour in the other principal ingredient. This is a solution of formaldehyde in water, commonly known as formalin. It so happens that these two chemicals have a natural tendency to react upon each other and combine. But to further aid this reaction, Dr. Bakelite added a catalyst, or chemical agent, such as this. The solution is now ready for the next step, heating. By magnifying the molecules of phenol and formaldehyde a few million diameters, we can observe what happens as the reaction proceeds. Because these starting molecules are different, this is called a condensation process. The water resulting from the condensation is removed by replacing the reflux condenser with one of ordinary type. Now, under the action of continued heat, the water is evaporated off into this other container. Now, the resin-like substance left in the flask, Dr. Bakelite called phenolic resinoid A, or his primary product.
What's the meaning of the word resinoid?
Oh, it was coined by Dr. Bakelite to distinguish his new synthetic materials from natural resins.
By the way, is that where the trade name Bakelite came from? Dr. Bakelite, the inventor?
Correct.
May I ask why the resinoid is called a primary product at this stage?
In the A stage, it can be melted and thinned or hardened and pulverized. This is the point where it's adapted to different kinds of fabrication, like molding and casting, for example.
Possible. I'd like to see one of those operations.
Well, casting is simplest because it's done directly from the primary resinoid. So I'll cast a small rod to show you what occurs in the final stage of Dr. Bakelite's process. In this closed chamber, the liquid resinoid in the tube can be heated under controlled conditions. This factor of control is all important. Unlike the molecules at the start of the first stage, these, you will notice, are all the same. Now keep a sharp eye on them. Several of the smaller ones are combining to form larger molecules. The result is a material of the same chemical composition, but with entirely different physical properties. This process chemists call polymerization. By means of it, phenolic resinoid changes from the fusible and finally turns, or freezes, into resinoid C. It's now a hard, insoluble, and infusible solid, which takes the exact form of the mold, in this case a test tube. And here's our cast rod, an exact duplicate of the one first cast by Dr. Bakeland in his own laboratory back in 1907.
It's like a fine piece of amber. Are all the materials that you now produce made from the original formula?
No, indeed. Hundreds of new formulas have been developed since the original invention. Many new raw materials and processes have been introduced, resulting in over 2,000 different types of Bakelite materials.
To grow to that number, they must have played an important part in the progress of industry since 1907.
Oh, it'd take volumes to tell that story. For example, they made possible the foolproof ignition system of the automobile. They've expanded to 1,000 uses and places in our communication systems, telephone, telegraph, and radio. They grew up with the aviation industry. But the list is endless. Perhaps the best way to illustrate their importance to industry today is to take you to Bound Brook, where Bakelite materials are made on a commercial scale.
Out of the discoveries and patents of Dr. L.H. Bakeland has grown a world-circling empire of plastics. And here is its capital, Bound Brook, New Jersey. Every building and room of this modern 125-acre plant was designed for but one purpose: the manufacture of Bakelite materials. Its production equipment is the perfected development of a quarter century's experience in making plastics. Many raw materials are now manufactured, an infinite variety of primary resinoids covering a wide range of special characteristics and properties. These, alone or in combination with numerous fillers and solvents, make up the more than 2,000 different Bakelite materials. They are supplied to the trade, ready for use, in manifold forms suited to fabrication and quantity production. Molding materials, for example, are prepared as powders, molding flakes, board stock, and blanks. But regardless of form or application, all Bakelite materials, by virtue of their primary ingredient, the resinoid, possess in common a unique combination of superior properties. Exceptional in their tensile and impact strength, hardness, durability, and electrical characteristics, they have in addition high resistance to heat, water, and chemicals. Any of these qualities, furthermore, may be augmented by varying the type and amount of the modifying agent. Molding powder pouring into these telephone shell molds is prepared by combining resinoid with a cellulose filler. Fillers such as this and cotton fabric, asbestos, and minerals are incorporated in molding materials for their added value. Better molding qualities, greater toughness and strength, and in the case of mineral fillers, an increased degree of water and heat resistance. But the resinoid is the important ingredient. And it's this combination of characteristics, rather than any one single property, which inspired the use of molding materials in so many different products. From another form of molding material, called molding blanks and board stock, are fabricated special products needing unusual strength by reason of their form or use. And like this molded funnel, all types of these materials have the structure and resiliency necessary to withstand turning, drilling, threading, buffing, or any of the operations employed in machining metal. Bakelite materials entered the automotive field in molded distributor heads when Charles F. Kettering developed his Delco ignition and starting system. In these new plastics, Mr. Kettering found the dielectric strength, the resistance to heat, acids, oil, and moisture, in fact, the very insulating material which he needed. Now there are over 200 resinoid parts in the modern car. Long before listeners had heard the term radio, molding materials were aiding the makers of radio's parent, wireless telegraphy. Today, they guard 1,001 vital spots in the great broadcasting stations and home receiving sets. In the electrical industry, the molding of instrument cases is typical of simplified production. Formerly involving 15 machining and finishing operations, they now are made with resinoids in a single closing of the press. Big or little, resinoid molding materials are equally adaptable, as witness these tiny insulator bushings, and these two examples among many home electrical devices. Development of scores of materials for special uses has prompted the spread of molded applications into many diverse and new fields. Here, for instance, are products fabricated from a more heat-resistant material of the mineral fill type. Another new variety, impact materials, has several times the shock resistance of ordinary molded plastics. This product consists of phenolic resinoid processed with specially selected fibrous fillers. Holding the spotlight in modern merchandising are packages and closures produced from molding materials. The unmistakable feel of quality, the sales appeal, and utility of these colored molded products have earned their approval by retailers and public alike. Then, too, the inert, chemical-resistant properties of the materials make possible sanitary leak-proof jar, tube, and bottle tops. These resist alcohol and are non-corrodible. Novelties likewise have joined the army of products whose appearance is enhanced through the use of these brilliant surfaced materials. Transparent materials are produced from pure resinoid without the use of fillers. They are cast in lead molds and converted into consumer products by machining. Rivaling precious jewels in color and depth, they are among the most beautiful of resinoid products. For the manufacturer, artist, designer, and amateur craftsman, they have opened up a new field of wide possibilities. And for the public, new means of decoration and service.
This jet necklace, madam, is Bakelite resinoid. We consider it equal, if not better, than the natural mineral.
It's beautiful. And how light. And so smooth and warm to the touch. But will it keep its fine appearance?
Yes, permanently. As a matter of fact, Bakelite jewelry has many advantages over glass, porcelain, and natural stones. To start with, it's flawless. Then, too, it is strong and hard without being fragile.
The material in this holder is so strong that a 7-passenger car can be hung on a 1-inch rod of it. An engineer told me that.
Well, then it can't be amber. That's quite brittle.
No, sir, it's called Bakelite resinoid. Notice the smooth surface on this pipe stem. The material is dense, non-absorbent, and has an enduring finish. That's why it's not affected by mouth or tobacco acid.
Among their many strictly utilitarian uses, Bakelite transparent materials, by reason of their chemical resistant properties, supply graduates, bottles, and other laboratory apparatus which must withstand the destructive action of hydrofluoric acid. And thereby they meet a century-old demand of chemists. Laminated materials are products of the chemical merger of phenolic resinoids with layers of paper or fabric. Under controlled and recorded conditions, great rolls of laminating fabric are uniformly coated with resinoid in varnish form. Dried and then cut into sheets, the processed fabric is weighed and stacked between polished metal plates. This impregnated mass goes now into a hydraulic press wherein the miracle of polymerization takes place under heat. Soon it comes out a hard, dense, rigid plate which requires only trimming to size. But in any of its forms, sheets, tubes, or rods, laminated makes available to industry a material with high resistance to moisture, uniform wear, resistance to temperature and chemicals. Outstanding also are its ease of fabrication and remarkable insulation qualities, its freedom from fracture and structural variation, its high tensile and compressive strengths. Its applications are legion. Suited to mass production, all manner of articles are punched from it. In a host of parts on practically every make of radio set, Bakelite laminated has become the standard insulating material. Equally wide is its service in 100 critical places in central stations and throughout the electric power industry. It is the durable material of silent gears in industrial machinery and automobile timing trains. And from still another type of laminated stock are cut the breaker strips for the doors of automatic refrigerators. It may be had in a range of colored effects from lustrous jet black to robin's egg blue, combined, if desired, with tinted metal inlays and photo murals. It is the newest and most versatile medium of the modern designer and architect. Bakelite lacquers are made by dissolving primary resinoid in suitable solvents. Light amber in color, they are intended primarily as protective coating. to highly finished articles, they are applied by machine dipping or by spraying with standard airbrush equipment. The thin film of resinoid is then oven-baked into a brilliant and wear-proof coating. By reason of its high mechanical bonding strength, dielectric value, and resistance to oil, water, dirt, and gasoline, Bakelite varnish is widely used as an insulating bond and protective coating for coils, armatures, and windings. To automotive brake linings, it imparts long life and resistance to friction heat. It even protects museum fossils. Resinoid cement contains a solid reinforcing body in addition to the resinoid and solvents. One type, lamp basing cement, has long been used to seal electric lamps and radio tubes in their bases. Another, bristle setting cement, furnishes a solvent-resistant bond and makes possible the assembly of the bristles and handles in one operation. Can you imagine a mechanical device containing 75 million sharp cutting tools? Believe it or not, you are watching the manufacture of such an incredible industrial implement. It's a modern high-speed abrasive wheel, bonded with Bakelite resinoid. Without these faster cutting, safer, cooler running, grinding wheels, it would be impossible to machine and use the present day alloy steels. And only through high accuracy in quantity production, which grinding alone can achieve at low cost, is industry able to produce economically high speed, high powered machinery, tools, automobiles, and aircraft. Together of sheets of wood or veneers, now called plywood, dates back 35 centuries to the Egyptian pharaohs. But until the introduction of resinoid bonds for the plywood industry, delamination and stains were a constant source of trouble in wet gluing. These resinoid adhesives knit the wood fibers securely together and form a synthetic wood more uniformly durable and stronger than the original lumber. And heat, humidity, water, vermin, and fungi, none of these enemies of ordinary wet glued veneers can impair the lasting qualities of resinoid bonded plywoods. Behind this container of resinoid denture material stretched 20 years of research in the Bakelite laboratories. From the first operation, Luxine technique is simple. Placed under heat, the resinoid becomes semi-fluid and enters into every crevice of the mold. And when the mold is later removed and opened, the denture is found cured into a hard, dense material, a permanent reproduction of the wax pattern. Stripped of plaster and tin foil, it requires only finishing and polishing with the dentist's regular equipment. And combined in it are natural color, strength, luster, lack of odor and taste, hygienic advantages, and repairability. These are the properties that have induced over 1 million men and women to use a Luxine denture. New possibilities in industry, decoration, and apparel are offered by Revolite, an amazingly versatile fabric treated with still another Bakelite product, flexible resinoid. In contrast to the surface-coated cloth on the market today, Revolite is processed so that the resinoid is forced into the fibers of the material, thereby becoming an integral part of the fabric. It is a waterproof cloth, resistant to chemicals, and can be washed with soap and water and safely ironed. Revolite is made in a wide range of colors and brilliant metallic finishes. Its beauty and utility, and its usability both indoors and out, make this modern material particularly desirable for the upholsterer, the manufacturer of household coverings, the interior and stage decorator, and the designer of woman's apparel. Synthetic resins for paints and varnishes are produced to meet the present demands for quicker drying and more durable finishes. The paint manufacturer's chemist, however, sees in these resins an opportunity to strengthen the desirable qualities in his company's products to meet more completely the constant requests for special purpose paints and varnishes, even to open up whole new markets. New types of bridges, modern structures, and streamlined trains utilizing new materials and design have all presented difficult problems of surface protection. Surrounded as they are in seacoast regions and industrial centers by atmosphere laden with salt spray, corrosive acids, and alkalis, their upkeep has always been a costly matter. But durable protective coatings based on synthetic phenolic resins now pave the way for substantial economies in maintenance costs. Resistance to abrasion and washing compounds is another fundamental quality of synthetic resin finishes, which is bringing about their extended application on floors and automobile bodies, or on any surface subject to excessive wear. The industries must have the protection of chemically resistant varnishes and paints. Furniture and product finishes demand gloss, luster retention, and durability. Aircraft finishes need resistance to sun and sleet, fumes, and dirt. Yacht and marine craft finishes must withstand sun, rain, and salt spray. These are but few of the specifications of Bakelite resin paints and varnishes. Born in a chemist's test tube into the fourth kingdom of primary substances, resinoid plastics grew up and were made useful in these extensive research laboratories of the Bakelite Corporation. And here, too, they are multiplied and adapted to the future needs of every industry on Earth. Their limitless applications can be measured only by the sign for infinity, and that the symbolic trademark of Bakelite products.
Bakelite, the well-known electrical insulating material, a documentary from 1937. To bring us up to 11 p.m. and the live crossbands that we have normally, or the live contacts, I should say, we're not crossbanding at the moment, although I probably will listen on 80 meters. A couple of documentaries that were recently made available by the Library of Congress in America. One is a documentary called Radio and Television 1940, A Vocational Guide. This is a guide for people who wanted to get into the radio industry. And then NBC presents Behind Your Radio Dial. It's an overview of the radio industry as it was in 1948. Both of them with sound that I've restored from the Library of Congress upload. So let me take you back nearly 80 years to the radio industry as it was then.
Thank you. Have you ever looked inside your radio? You probably have, and perhaps you've taken the tubes out to test them. The vacuum tube makes it possible to transmit sound, whether by radio, a loudspeaker system, or a motion picture projector. The vacuum tube has been responsible for the growth of radio into a business involving thousands of people and millions of dollars. Like any business, radio broadcast employs a great many people in general office work, such as correspondents, stenographers, file clerks, and bookkeepers. Executives and managers of special departments, salesmen who sell time on the air to advertisers, experts who select the talent for programs, are all a necessary part of radio broadcasting. Continuity writers prepare script, and other writers handle publicity, news, and material for special educational and farm programs. News commentators broadcast stories gathered from all corners of the world, often analyzing important events and expressing their own opinions regarding them. For regularly scheduled programs, the production department has a multitude of duties to perform, primarily concerned with planning and preparing the programs to go on the air. Sound effects add realism to dramatic programs and are produced by specialists in a small, although very interesting field. Actors and actresses perform for unseen audiences, and control men skillfully operate the apparatus which mixes sound effects, music, and dialogue. The best the world has to offer in music, drama, and comedy may be enjoyed in one's own home, for radio's greatest application is in broadcasting mass entertainment. Many programs are broadcast over radio networks, and telephone lines are employed to connect the studio with the various stations. As a program may originate in a studio at New York or Hollywood, the use of telephone wires makes it possible for stations thousands of miles away to broadcast the program. The master controls are operated by men who have advanced from the ranks. Their work requires perfect coordination of mind and hand, for station hookups must be made on the split second. During the short period allowed for station identification, telephone lines, which have been set up in advance, are connected to feed the program to the network stations. The maintenance of radio broadcasting equipment employs a large number of workers known as technicians. It is their job to see that the apparatus is kept in perfect working order. In the stations, we find these men at work on the amplifiers and on the power equipment. They are not developing new methods or devices, but are maintaining those which have already been developed by the engineer. Radio engineers are men technically trained in the field of electrical engineering as applied to radio and communications. They have brought about the high degree of perfection now attained both in broadcasting equipment and in radio receiving sets. This work of improvement and development is continually being carried on by the relatively small number of highly trained specialists who are radio engineers. Theirs are among the top positions in radio. These positions have been filled by men without professional training, but today there is little chance for a man to become a radio engineer without training in a first-class engineering school. Radio manufacturing in general is classified as unskilled work, as most of the jobs can be mastered in a very short time. Many women are employed assembling and inspecting radios, as the work is not heavy. Ordinarily, such work does not lead to responsible positions and should be avoided unless one will be satisfied with employment in manufacturing. However, men with training are sometimes placed in the production departments of radio manufacturing plants to gain practical experience. This work serves also as a proving ground for these men, and those who qualify may advance to positions of greater responsibility. Because radio broadcasts are so popular, the public demands prompt and efficient repair service to radio sets. This has created a large field of employment. However, the supply of radio servicemen generally exceeds the need, and this makes it extremely difficult for any but the well-trained to succeed in the work. Often, the most successful radio dealers and salesmen are those who can talk about the products they sell, frequently because they've had practical experience in radio repair work. the radio service field is not a good stepping stone to the radio engineer's job unless it is followed or accompanied by technical engineering training. A very interesting field of work is that of the radio operator who sends and receives messages. He must be able to send and receive the international Morse code at a specified number of words per minute. Granting of the commercial operator's license is based on a rigid government examination conducted by the Federal Communications Commission, and it must be renewed periodically. Radio operators are found on practically all large ships. They communicate with other ships and with radio stations on land. The operator at the land station sends and receives commercial messages, handles weather reports, and listens for distress signals from ships at sea. Air travel has become safe today largely because of the application of radio principles. On commercial airlines, the licensed pilots must be radio operators. In addition to flying the plane, they must report their positions and get their bearings, weather information, and landing instructions from the radio operators at the ground stations. The ground station operator does not have to be an aviator. In addition to handling messages, he must understand the theory of radio and how to make minor repairs in order to keep his station on the air. The operator's work is to maintain contact with planes in flight, as well as to communicate with other airports regarding schedules, passenger reservations, and weather conditions. Men with radio training often find employment in allied lines using basic radio principles. Among these is a sound movie. Through the use of microphone, amplifier, and vacuum tube, the sound for motion pictures is photographically recorded on the edge of the film to form the soundtrack. When the soundtrack reaches the thousands of theaters, it is reproduced by means of a photoelectric cell, or electric eye, amplifiers, and a loudspeaker system. Maintenance men with fundamental knowledge of radio technique are constantly employed to keep this delicate equipment in working order. Public address systems also use some of the principles of radio. They range from the temporary and portable unit to permanent installations in large auditoriums. Many operators of portable public address systems own their own equipment, which is in demand at county fairs, sporting events, political rallies, and conventions. This type of work requires some special training, but the field is so crowded that it offers few really good jobs. The better jobs are those planning and installing the large permanent public address systems, but this work requires a thorough background in radio and acoustical engineering. Another field requiring thorough engineering training is the transmission of photographs by wire and radio. New services maintain photo transmitters at strategic points, and the newspapers subscribing to this service get the photographs over receiving instruments in their own offices. Television, the baby of the radio family, is creating openings for experienced engineers, most of whom are graduating from radio work. From the scene of action, cameramen televise events which you may see in your own home, if, of course, you have a television receiver. Television is opening up a new field, as does any new development. It is furnishing employment for men who design, operate, install, and service the transmitters and receivers. But men with radio experience, especially those who have prepared themselves through study and application, are given preference. Specialized training, study, and hard work are necessary in all phases of radio. In spite of the size and importance of the radio field, it doesn't hold great opportunity except for those who are able to secure the highly technical training which it requires. The best training is that obtained at a first-class electrical engineering school, specializing in communications engineering. If that is impossible, there are a few vocational and correspondence schools which offer excellent courses in the theory of radio. However, you should ask your school authorities to help you investigate any school, residence or correspondence, which you may plan to attend. Your high school preparation for entrance into radio work must lay a strong foundation in science and mathematics, the basis of all engineering, and especially of electrical engineering. You must, in addition, develop a high degree of coordination between hand and mind, because much of the work is very exacting in nature. If you are really interested in radio as your life work, probably one of the best ways to get started is to make it a hobby and build an amateur station. This will give you the chance to put basic theory in practical operation. It will show you more quickly than anything else whether or not you can succeed in radio.
NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
That sound is heard more often by more people than any other sound in America. Pulsing out from the transmitter tower into the tubes and coils behind your radio dial, whoever, wherever you may be. It's like a welcome knock on the door and the sound of the familiar voice of an old friend. Welcome voice of NBC speaks many languages, music, the crosstalk of forum and discussion. It speaks the clipped and colorful lingo of sport, the many hundred tongues and tones of drama. It speaks the language of laughter, the rippling idiom of comedy. And it tells the world of how the world spins with the voice of truth. These are voices of NBC today, versatile and modulated. But do you remember more than 20 years ago when radio was learning to talk?
Secretary of State Charles Evans Hughes defended the Harding administration course on the League of Nations today when asked whether it wasn't time for the Republican Party to give the people an unequivocal statement in regard to its position on the world court. He denied that...
Its voice was a whisper crackling with static, and you stayed up till 3 scratching a crystal with a wire cat's whisker to log Pittsburgh, 50 miles away. And then radio moved up from the cellar to the parlor, its earphones replaced by a handsome cone speaker, big enough for Dad to get his whole head in as he still tried for distance, maybe Cincinnati direct on a clear evening. But it was a magic night late in 1926 when Dad switched to his local station and found that it was linked by telephone lines to 19 other stations, to form the National Broadcasting Company. The creation of this pioneer network meant that a broadcast originating from any of these affiliated stations could be heard clearly in the area served by all the others, and always at the same spot on Dad's dial. Now radio was going places, and NBC went with it, extending its network from coast to coast, spanning the nation, to bring the on-the-spot, play-by-play report of Graham McNamee describing the doings in Pasadena's sunny Rose Bowl to winterbound listeners in New York. But millions of widely separated people were still to be turned into next-door neighbors,
And so the cross-continental chain became a permanent web, and the web was woven into a fabric, and the fabric covers the nation, reaches up into Canada, across the Pacific, America's number one network, more than 170 stations, independent community stations, of which only six are owned and operated by NBC. But to affiliates and key stations alike, the industry's focal point is in Radio City, the city within a city. Here at New York's Rockefeller Center is home site and hearth side for the NBC family. And here the welcome mat is laid out for over 500,000 visitors a year. Friends from all over the world who've dropped in to see what goes on behind their radio dial. The NBC guides would have to be graduate engineers to answer all the questions that people ask on our regular tours about how a radio show is actually put on the air. That was a simpler story in the old days when this antique master control desk took only one man to operate. But today, it requires a whole team to man the panel board. From this room, programs all around the clock are routed over 16,000 miles of leased telephone lines to radio stations all over the nation. This is the nerve center of NBC. You know, what you hear on the air represents only a fraction of the effort that goes into network radio. The microphone doesn't pick up, for example, the sound of the teletypes in the communications department, which connect our key cities and handle the 3,000 messages a day which are necessary to bring your shows in on cue. You can't tune in on the traffic department either, but without it, no telling what you'd get. For on this board, every minute of the broadcast day is programmed weeks in advance, be constantly checked and rechecked for split-second transmission to the proper station. Our guests naturally always want to see some of the voices that they hear every day at home, so they usually stop in on a rehearsal studio. Here, behind a soundproof window, they can eavesdrop on a popular daytime serial, getting a final run-through before airtime.
Thank you, nurse.
Do you want me to stay, doctor?
No, it won't be necessary, thank you, nurse.
Yes, doctor.
Sit down, Mrs. Everett, please.
Well, doctor, maybe you found out what's wrong with my husband. Maybe you can tell me about him. All those other doctors...
Gertrude, that's swell. I liked your entry line. It was flat and it's good characterization. Now, I want to get two emotions in this last speech of yours.
I want to feel on that line where you sit down that you're more nervous about entering a doctor's office.
Oh.
I think most people
generally are. And also on the other line in that little sentence there, make sure that I have the feeling that you are concerned about your husband's health. It's very serious.
Oh, I
Is
see.
Is that clear?
Yes, I see.
Just those two emotions
right.
in that sentence. All right, let's run that scene again from page 18 with the doctor's line, sit down, Mrs. Everett, please. On cue now. All right.
Sit down, Mrs. Everett.
I guess people are more current events conscious these days because they always want to see the NBC newsroom and maybe catch a glimpse of the dean of commentators, Mr. Kaltenborn.
And that's the news picture as it looks in post-war Europe tonight. Confused enough to be sure, but certainly not altogether hopeless. Good night. Well, I've just helped turn another day over to history. But history has no clocks and has no calendars. And that's why NBC has provided a room where history can be recorded eternally. That's the newsroom. Let's visit it for a bit, shall we? All night and all day, every day in the year, these machines bring the world's news to NBC for processing. A bell signal will indicate that a really hot news story is on the wire. But usually, they just tick away the ordinary everyday facts about the daily doings of humanity, scarcely pausing between stories on the national debt the international crisis, and the national league. It is our job here to sift these facts, to analyze and evaluate them, bring them into focus with their background, and turn them into stories for radio's newspaper, the only newspaper which is perpetually going to press. Radio's magnificent job of reporting the news is a matter of record. Very little of note has occurred in the last 20 years that hasn't cut a groove in the wax of NBC's permanent transcription file. For radio is not just a thing of the moment. Reserved for all time in its archives are the sounds, the words that history made and spoke as they happened, while it was actually happening.
And there's the Winnie Mae now, winging her way in with a new world's record. Around the world in the record time of 8 days, 15 hours, and 15 minutes. The crowd's rushing out on the field to meet the ship as it taxis up the runway. And from where I am, I can't see Getty, but that looks like Wiley Post now, getting out of the plane. I've got the NBC microphone through this crowd, and it just... Wiley, will you and Harold...
Bill, now they've dropped rope out of the nose of the ship, and the passenger probably is lining the windows looking down.
It burst into flames. Wait, get this started, get this started. It's crashing, it's crashing terrible.
If I am elected president of the United States, with confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
And from this room, NBC sent you its reports, hour by hour, and sometimes even minute by minute, on the greatest news story of all time, the Second World War. It followed the news wherever it went and sent back eyewitness accounts of the tide of global battle, sent back the actual sound made by a world coming apart at the seams. And so today, NBC News and Special Events, mindful of its obligation to keep America informed, has enlarged its facilities so that everyone, in sound of a radio, has his ear to the ground.
It is not intended to suspend the decision of the Security Council by an understanding that these answers have to be in before we act.
If you looked closely enough behind your radio dial, you would inevitably find people. At NBC, important people. In the mailroom, for instance, the clerks who handle the thousands of letters you write into us every day. More letters than are received in many a good-sized post office. And the people in the information department who see to it that every letter is answered. For modern network radio is more than just a man with a microphone. It is 1,000 men and women performing tasks without which your receiver would be just a silent piece of furniture. Yes, radio is people. Everyone from the man who tells you who's in Studio 8H to the men who make a living slamming doors and breaking dishes. Radio is also the anonymous standby pianist who on a moment's notice must fill an emergency silence with music. And it's the director, the producer, and the composer, too. People whose voices are never heard on the air, but who have made NBC's music department the finest in the radio industry. A mass of specialized detail goes into the preparation of a musical program. Every selection must first be investigated for clearance and performance rights. When the numbers have been cleared for broadcast, some are turned over to the composing staff and special arrangements are prepared. The balance of the program may come from orchestrations on file at NBC, the largest and most complete working music library in the world, containing everything from swing to symphony. Rehearsal or the Fred Waring Show, and the talent of the singer is deftly woven into the pattern of the program. It takes many hours of patient practice to tailor the artistic and technical quality of every note transmitted to your loudspeaker. Rehearsing, revising, rewriting, time to the relentless sweep hand of the stopwatch, and finally, they're on the air.
Fred Waring and the Pennsylvanians broadcasting today from Radio City in New York, and here to greet you on this nice Thursday is your host, Fred Waring.
Hello, everybody, and thanks for coming.
NBC New York is also the eastern terminus of radio's most famous thoroughfare, Allen's Alley.
Tell me, Mr. Moody, what are your feelings about the radio?
I don't hold with furniture that talks.
Well, you have a radio.
No, I had one in the hen house.
Yeah?
One day, all the hen's nest would be empty.
Uh-huh.
Next day, every nest would have two eggs into it.
You mean?
The hens was listening to Double or Nothing.
Yeah.
Co-capital of world entertainment is NBC's Western Radio City in Hollywood. The names they write in autograph books outside NBC Hollywood are those of the greatest stars in radio and the most in demand for advertising sponsorship.
Not late for a date, are you, Charlie?
I haven't got one.
Oh, that's too bad.
If you're not doing anything, I...
No, you don't.
I was afraid of that.
That's it?
Yeah. Well, isn't it an exact likeness?
Hello,
George.
I stood 3 hours.
Pork chops? I told you this morning we're having chicken for lunch.
No, sir, we have pork chops.
Rochester, we're having chicken.
Okay, but don't look for no wings.
You gotta hurry and pack. We'll travel light. It's the thing to do these days.
Where are the suitcases?
Right here in the hall bus.
The money that advertisers spend to sponsor these shows pays for other programs, too. Non-commercial broadcasts in the public service account for more than 40% of NBC's scheduled time. The network makes free time available for roundtable discussions and farm and home programs. It provides regular facilities, free and impartially, to the three major faiths. And it divides the air fairly and without cost so that the voices of labor, management, and agriculture can all be heard. But neither network nor sponsors ultimately decide what you shall hear. To determine the most popular types of radio entertainment, NBC engages in constant research by telephone.
Hello, this is the Program Rating Service. We are conducting a survey of radio listening. Were you listening to your radio just now? To what program were you listening, please?
By careful attendance to the wishes expressed in letters sent in by listeners all over the world. By carefully worked out scientific tests.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have invited you here to participate in testing a proposed radio program. We want you to register your approval or disapproval at various points in the program on those reaction sheets that you hold. As the light flashes on the screen, please let us know how you feel about the program by checking either good or fair or poor alongside the corresponding number on your reaction sheet.
And by direct contact.
A kind of a program you'd recommend for your child or your
grandchildren.
Amusing.
Amusing.
Interesting to the
children. Entertaining for them.
I think that was very nice for children, but I don't believe that a great many grown-ups would care to listen to it.
How did you feel? You've heard these older folks say it's a good program for youngsters. How do you feel being a youngster?
Well, it was boring at first, but then it got a little interesting as it went on in history.
All right, you feel perhaps the program
childish.
A little childish.
That's right.
NBC's obligation to its listeners is founded on its basic respect for the American home. All material for the microphone is examined in the light of a zealously guarded code, the ordinary standards of good taste and public conscience, incorporated into the network's program policy. For NBC knows that vigilance is the price that radio must pay for its stewardship of the air. It knows that responsibility is the first obligation of freedom. Freedom of every American to turn the switch on his radio and listen without a license to what he pleases when he pleases, and to pay no tribute for what he hears, was guaranteed by the Constitution more than 100 years before the first practical sputter was ever coaxed out of the electromagnetic wave. The freedom of the air in America is inalienable. To extend this American freedom into new and uncharted wavelengths, NBC, in 1941, established the first commercial television station in the country, began immediately to expand it into a network. Adding sight to sound, it opened an electronic window, rang up a magic curtain, and ushered you to the first row, to the best seat in the house, your own easy chair. Crystal of yesterday's radio is the crystal ball of television, in which is visible a whole new era of communications. In one generation, voice and vision have transcended space. Science, engineering, and organization have harnessed the ratio between light and sound, so that radio or television, if you look behind your dial that is set at NBC, you will find that you are tuned in on today and focus on tomorrow.